This meeting to order. Happy St. Patrick's Day. Thank you all for coming. We appreciate the Titans hosting us today at Nissan Stadium. In an effort to streamline our meetings, we would ask that our presenters try and keep their presentations to under 10 minutes, and then we'll have ample time for our board to ask as many questions as necessary. And as always, when you're presenting, please introduce yourself for those watching on the internet or at home that don't know you. And for the record to reflect who's who. Also, the appeals process for any action of this body can be found at the top of today's agenda. As you can see, we have a couple of new faces here this morning. And I am excited to have the opportunity to introduce two new board members. But before doing so, I want to thank David Wicker and Marcus Curry for their service to this board and our city. We really all have enjoyed serving with them and really appreciate all the hard work that they've done on behalf of the Sports Authority. So we have two new members today. We have Lisa Howe, who's at the end of the table here. We don't have a name tags yet or nameplates. Lisa had a successful 17-year career as a head collegiate women's soccer coach, most recently coaching at Belmont. She is the executive director for the Nashville LGBT Chamber of Commerce and recently completed the Nashville Emerging Leaders Program. Kalat Hama is a cancer clinical researcher with Vanderbilt and has been very active in the Salah Hadeen Center of Nashville. Kalat is an advocate who has worked to bring minority groups together and build a better sense of community in our city. I also understand she will be rooting for the governors tonight because she is an avid fan of Austin Peay State University, where she received her master's. Both Lisa and Kalat were confirmed by the Metro Council on Tuesday night, and please join me in welcoming them to this meeting. And if staff could send us an updated list of the board contacts.
It's fine, tab two.
Excellent. She's already on it. Thank you, Alicia.
We love her.
She is on it. First on our agenda, we have approval of our meeting minutes from our February 18th board meeting. Everyone should have had a chance to review. Are there any questions regarding the meeting minutes, or is there a motion to approve?
Motion to approve.
Second.
Motion is second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
The minutes are approved. At this time, we will have our executive director's report from our executive director, Monica.
Thank you. First, I would also like to congratulate Kalat and Lisa on their appointment to the authority. We're really excited to have you on board. And then I also want to congratulate our chair and Margaret Bim, who's not here today, on their reappointment for another term. So we, of course, appreciate the dedication and your hard work. You do have the agenda before you. I'm not going to go over it item by item, but I do want to point out the items that will require approval or action by the board. You've already approved the minutes from the February 18th meeting. The other action items are going to be the department's FY17 operating budget, which you have, and which has been vetted by the Finance Committee. Also, the Nissan Stadium electric vehicle chargers, that proposal will require action today. And then lastly, the competitor group license agreement. And I'll talk to you some more about that as we get there. It's been a great month. It's been a very full month. And I know that you will hear about the She Believes Cup, I'm sure, in the Nissan Stadium report. And also, I'm sure that the Predators will give an update on the SEC men's basketball tournament last weekend at Bridgestone Arena. So I don't want to spend too much time talking about that. But in the last couple of weeks, I've had some opportunities to talk about these events and some other events that take place in our facilities. First of all, to the Metro Council's Convention, Tourism, and Public Facilities Committee. And then also last week to Leadership Knoxville, who was in town for a few days. And they asked me to share about the work of the Sports Authority and then asked Governor Bredesen to come in and talk about his vision for the arena and just the process of bringing that arena downtown. And it really was a great time. And so what becomes more obvious to me as I have an opportunity to speak to different groups is just how much our facilities mean to people. You know, people, obviously those of us who live here, but also those who live just throughout the state. And so it's a wonderful thing to see. Lastly, Margaret Bem, like I said, is not here. And I think most of you all are aware of the Sports Council's Women in Sports initiative, and it was born out of the Women's Final Four, and she's been very instrumental in the formation of that group. And of course, you know, one of its primary goals is to promote women in sports. And so with that, in your packets on the table, you should have a flyer. We wanted to make you aware that the National Pro Fast Pitch will hold its college draft here on April the 14th. That league is headquartered here. A lot of people don't know that. And Sherry Kemp, their commissioner, is also an ESPN college softball analyst. But the draft is going to take place at the CMA Theater inside the Country Music Hall of Fame and will be broadcast on the CBS Sports Network. So if any of you are interested and are available to attend, I know they would love to have as many people come out and fill the theater as possible. If there are no other specific questions for me, that concludes my report.
Could we put this information on our website? Or
Absolutely.
Trying to make sure there's a central housing for all the different events in our facilities. And even though this isn't our event, it's the Country Music Hall of Fame, but I think that'd be helpful.
That's good. We'll do that. Any other questions?
Okay. Any questions for Monica? All right, thank you. We appreciate the report. At this time, we will hear our Finance Committee report, it will be given by Ralph Perry, one of our committee members.
Great. Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm a poor stand-in for Margaret Bem, but I will do the best I can. Your Finance Committee met earlier this month. The meeting's minutes are, I believe, behind tab 3. Let's get to the important one first, and that is the budget that is before you. It comes to you with a recommendation for approval from the committee. It is essentially the same budget that we approved last year. With one exception, there is a request for a $35,000 improvement, which will pay for one additional full-time employee who would be dedicated to working with special events. We had a good discussion about that. You may not realize that the number of events in the Nissan Stadium footprint has increased by 177% over the last 3 years, and that our partners at Cumberland Park and Ascend Amphitheater anticipate a doubling of the number of events that will be held in those facilities. So, an anticipation that there's a lot more activity and that those events don't just fall into place on their own. The recommendation is that the Sports Authority add one full-time equivalent to work in partnership with the Mayor's Special Events Team and the sponsors of those events. That's the only change in the budget that you're familiar with from last year, and on behalf of the committee, I would move approval.
Second.
Let me, if I can add one more thing just to clarify, it is a $35,000 regular pay enhancement. Mm-hmm. The Finance Department has asked us to make sure that we include the fringes with that. So when you total those, it is a $53,700
I stand correct.
Total.
Monica, what are the fringes? When I was reading through that, I wasn't sure what those were.
So that is, it's mostly health benefits.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
Gotcha. Thanks.
It's more benefits than fringe.
Yeah.
Right. Thank you.
Right.
Nobody gets a car. Things like that.
Thanks.
I believe there was a motion and a second. Is there any other discussion? Question? We have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.
Great. One other point of information, also in your packet, we've always had very detailed financial reports. relative to stadium operations. And you will find a new format here. This has been worked out by Janine and the Titans in cooperation with Metro Legal and Metro Finance. We found it to be a much easier to read and understand summary of projects that are in the works, projects that have been completed and anticipate submittal for reimbursement, and also a look ahead to projects, capital projects anticipated over the next year or two. This will, I think, be a useful tool for all of us as we track those things and make plans for how we pay for them going forward. It's just, especially for the benefit of our newer members, Metro, under the lease, budgets $1 million a year for capital expenses incurred at the stadium. The Titans typically take care of those, and when necessary, they carry a balance forward until Metro catches up with its appropriation. The Titans are carrying a balance of about $5 million of unreimbursed expense right now, which, Steve, correct me, that is probably the largest amount that you all have carried for some time.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
So largest to date.
Yeah. And
however, Ralph, with your permission, I do want to stress that we're not concerned. We don't view it urgently. It's not.
No. And you all have been great partners. And actually, you know, I meant to compliment the Titans because the aggressive effort they've taken toward maintenance and capital improvement over the years has actually pushed back the date and which we would have otherwise expected to have a major capital undertaking. The seat replacement work that's underway right now, for example, the original studies anticipated that would have been necessary in year 7. I think we're in year 17. So that's been typical of the good work and partnership we've had with you. But the committee, I think, rightly looks ahead to that. There's a limit to how much we might reasonably expect the Titans to carry forward year after year. And as we continue to have capital expenses year after year that exceed $1 million, at some point we have to work with the city and talk to Metro Finance about just how we anticipate paying for this, because clearly $1 million a year isn't going to continue to cover that. There might be a number of ways to do that. I'm sure Rich Riebling has thought of 3 or 4 already. But we just bring that to each of you as a matter of information, because it'll be something that we want to talk about and plan for as we go forward. That concludes my report, Madam Chair.
And the spreadsheet that that Ralph is referring to is behind tab 5 behind the Times report.
Thank you for the report, Ralph. Very informative. Next up, I believe we will hear from on the budget. We did that with the do we need to do a separate motion for the overall budget? I didn't know if that needed a second action. Okay, thank you. Next up, we have our Nissan Stadium report from representatives of the Titans. Thank you.
I am Walter Overton, General Manager of Nissan Stadium. Good morning, Madam Chair. Good morning, board members.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It has been a busy month here at Nissan Stadium. Since we last met, our most recent event was the She Believes Cup. Fantastic women's soccer. We had 4 of the top 5 professional women's soccer teams here at Nissan Stadium with the match. We had the United States, we had Germany, we had France, and we had England. It was a beautiful day. We had a record-setting crowd of more than 25,000 fans, which sets a record for a women's soccer match in the state of Tennessee. There were long lines with funnel cakes, long lines with trying to get souvenirs. So it was just a wonderful day, and we certainly enjoyed hosting that soccer match. We sold tickets from over 42 states. Also, tickets were being sold in England, Ireland, and Canada. So we had a variety of people that came here to Nashville to enjoy our city and enjoy the soccer match at Nissan Stadium. With our ticket sales, it's gone very, very well. We are looking forward to our upcoming events with Beyonce, which will be May the 5th. Before that, just to mention, I'm sure that's been in the news about our spelling bee, which we hosted here last Sunday, the regional spelling bee, which I had the opportunity to be there for a short while and watch the contestants spell words. Some were very impressive, some were not. So it was an emotional swing up and down. So it was very exciting to have it in the West Club. We also will be hosting this weekend the Sports Fest, which is sponsored by 104.5 Cumulus. We are preparing for that to have that event here at Nissan Stadium Saturday. So it should be a well-attended event. They have that speaker series. You'll have fans being able to have interactive games on the field. They will be able to go down into the locker room and have a lot of other events and tables and sponsors in the East Concourse. So there's a lot of things that are going on. In June 9th, we'll have our CMAs, which is Nashville's signature event. And I think they've already started announcing the lineup, some of the lineup. I don't think they've gotten all of the lineup announced, but they've started announcing the lineup, which is a very spectacular superstar lineup, as they usually will do. It's always a big time show. They come in about 2 weeks and take over the stadium, and we just give them the key and we make sure that it does happen. So then we have a new event, the 18th of June, which is the Monster Jam. That's a very exciting event. I have not had the opportunity to witness a Monster Jam in person, but I'm sure I'll have the opportunity up close and personal with this Monster Jam. So, anyway, all right, moving right along. Stadium improvements. We have resumed our east side ramp painting. If you've noticed from downtown, you can see the west side painting of the ramps. We had to stop the painting for the fall because the paint that's being used by the contractor, you cannot use that paint if the temperature is 50 degrees or less. So now that we got springtime in the air, the paint has resumed, and you'll see the painting of the east side ramps coming soon. Also, we are pressure washing the entire stadium. It's an opportunity that we are getting because of the fact that we are taking seats out and putting seats back in. So while the seats are out, we're taking advantage of the fact that we can pressure wash that area where the seats are being removed, because that area has not been particularly pressure washed thoroughly. We've had dirt and grime in those particular areas. So if at any time that you guys would want to see how it looks with the seats being removed, I'll be happy today to take you out on the field. We can't take you upstairs because that's certainly be a violation, because everybody does not have hard hats. But we could look, we could go down on the field and look up in the seats.
Walker,
and see.
I think we were going to do a brief walkthrough after.
Is that right? Okay, good.
Yes. So.
Good. Larry, you thought about doing that? I wasn't made aware of that. I had to do it.
I thought you made that happen.
I thought you were bringing the hats.
That's right. All right. We are, as always, we are trying to find more points of sale, concession stands. Bob has done an excellent job in finding ways in which we can have more points of sale. We have identified two up on the east, southeast, and southwest upper deck where we will be able to establish more points of sale for our fans, particularly in the upper level. There's a limited concession stand, so we're just trying to find more concession stands that our fans in the upper level can use. Our light rakers, I can recall that it's probably been close to maybe 8, 9, 10 years since our light rakers have been painted. Our light rakers are pink. We have two completed. We're working on a third. Then we'll have five more to go. So the light rakers are something that's very attractive. You can see from downtown, you can see from the interstate. The two on the northeast side, they look great. And we're looking forward to having them, all of the light rakers done by the time the season starts. Our fence painting is also underway. It's the fence that's up at the upper deck that, if you were sitting on the upper deck at the last level, it's the fence that would keep you in the stadium. So we've started painting with that special paint that you can't use under 50 degrees, and so that has really helped us to beautify the stadium. It really looks good now with the paint, with the red paint and silver. Parking lot signage. We have, Nissan has been so good, such a great partner that you now can establish and see where the actual parking lots are. They have put the letters, the alphabet letters on the light rakers so that you can see the light poles, so that you can see exactly where you can park. So that has been a great addition in terms of signage. We're so proud to have that. Are there any questions?
Well,
yes, sir.
That paint that you keep referring to, what's special about it? What does it do?
Emmett, I knew you'd ask me that.
Special paint, is there anything special about the paint?
It is a very dense material that is made for outdoors. And so it takes a very special application. It's not like just the paint you buy in a hardware store. It's made especially for things that are very much in the weather.
So it'll last a little longer out there.
That would be the, that is the hope. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Walter. No, I think we're good.
Thank you.
Hello, thank you for giving this opportunity to visit with you this morning. My name is Stuart Spears. I'm the Senior Vice President and Chief Revenue Officer for the Titans, and part of my responsibilities include overseeing and coordinating the activities in the ticket office. This time of year, the first quarter of the calendar year is always a very crucial period for us on the business side. It is the time that we are sending out renewals to our season ticket members and facilitating their renewal of their season tickets, handling any questions, inquiries they have about their accounts. The bulk of the vast majority of the people you see in the stadium on Sundays in the fall are all season ticket members, way more so than individual game purchasers. So this is a very critical piece for us, and consequently the Sports Authority, through ticket tax revenue to maintain and grow that base. So as well as just sending out the renewals, which I gave each of you a copy of the brochure that we sent out, that is what each season ticket member received. There's a brochure in there with information about the team, some special perks for season ticket members, a letter from our controlling owner, Amy Adams Strong, thanking them for their support and their participation in the Titans. So just wanted to share with you what we sent to them Also included in there is a refrigerator magnet that each person received with their season ticket representative's name and phone number on there. And so the hope is to make sure we communicate to each member that they've got an individualized rep that they can call with any questions or concerns. After sending out the renewal, we've got a coordinated program through the off-season to engage with each of our season ticket members, to make them feel a part of the team, to make sure they stay engaged with what's happening with their team. Began with our season ticket member luncheon and dinner that we did at the convention center last month. I know we saw a few of you guys out there, and we appreciated your attendance and hope you enjoyed the evening. We received an incredible amount of positive feedback from everybody that's able to attend, and we're very pleased with the way that turned out. Upcoming events between now and the end of the renewal process in late May, we're going to have our Titan Tuesday events in the stadium, where every Tuesday starting March 29th through late May, we invite season ticket members to come out to the club level, and we'll have a different program for them every week. The picture you see in your packet is from last year, one of the May Titan Tuesdays when we brought the rookie class out, and they all got to meet our new quarterback at that point, Marcus Mariota. But we'll have the head coach at one of the functions. Mr. Underwood will be at one of the functions. John Robinson will be at one of the functions. We'll have ownership representatives at one of the functions, just giving the season ticket members a chance to come out for a free reception and a chance to kind of mix and mingle with their team. Every year we have an exciting draft night party. Last year it was a lot of fun because we took Marcus Mariota, and there's a lot of excitement around the addition of a new quarterback to your team every year. And this year we have the number one pick in the draft, so there's a lot of excitement and anticipation of what's going to happen with that pick. The draft night party is open to all fans, and we'll promote it as such, but we have some exclusive season ticket member only opportunities built into the activities. Like last year, we had the AFC Championship trophy that was set up with a chance for season ticket members to see it, and so we'll have two or three different activities that are just for them to make them feel more valued as possible. Every May, since the Titans arrived in Tennessee in the late 90s, we do a caravan across the region, reaching out to Titan fans outside of Davidson County to go to as far east as Johnson City and the Tri-Cities areas, down into northern Alabama, up into Kentucky, and all the way over to Memphis. The outreach there is to cultivate Titan fans, both young and old, those that may not be able to be season ticket members, those that can come to a game here or there, maybe once or twice a year, but even those that can't even come to a game at all, just to spread the Titan gospel, if you will, and share with them the excitement that comes with Titan football. Looking at the first 2 weeks of May that we'll do that, so we'll build on the draft and the excitement that comes out of that the last week of April, and carry that through those 2 weeks. Titans 5K is something we've done the last several years. We're excited about that again. It's going to be the 21st of May. That'll be a Saturday, the weekend before Memorial Day. It's an event that continues to grow in strength and stature for us. The football side of our organization is a great partner on this event. John Robinson and Coach Malarkey and Coach Malarkey's wife are going to participate in the run. We'll have tons of players out there as well. And this achieves a lot of objectives for us as an organization. It's an outreach opportunity for people in a non-traditional manner, more than just selling tickets to a football game. It's able to promote good health amongst people. It started with Mayor Dean, and one of his big initiatives that he expressed to us is he wanted to find ways that his office and the Titans could promote activity amongst people. Not necessarily hardcore full marathons and so forth, but it's a 5K that you can get out. You can walk it, you can run it, you can do it in whatever pace you want. You just want to get people off the couch and out being active. And so we've taken that and we've run with it, pardon the pun, and have really been pleased with the way it's worked out, and it continues to grow each year, and something that the organization as a whole, not only from the football side, but from every part of the business side, pitches in and makes for a wonderful event. As I said, season ticket renewals went out around February 1st. When we were here last year and I was speaking with you, we were excited about the development of a service team that we had with four part-time individuals that were calling season ticket members, reaching out to them to try and fulfill their needs and essentially just provide a strong customer service network for them. We've developed so much and seen so much success with this that we've now expanded to six people and they're made full-time, and so the entire season ticket base is divided up amongst those six people, and those are some of the folks that you saw in your renewal packet, that when somebody got their renewal form, they saw that they're individual they could reach out to and ask any questions, get any help they need. Renewals are tracking at a similar pace to what they did last year. It's still early in the process. We sent out February 1st. We've had some deadlines and mile markers that we've hit. We give the people the option to pay in full, or they can split the payment in two, or they can sign up for a monthly payment plan that stretches out until the season starts. And so we're getting a strong response, and we'll continue to work on those people we haven't heard from yet over the course of the spring. New sales are ahead of where we were at this point in 2015, so we're very appreciative of that. Our sales team is working on the upstairs part of our ticket office on outbound phone calls now, addressing people who bought on a single game basis. People have expressed interest through some direct mail initiatives that we've done and some email initiatives we've done, and so they've got a nice pool of candidates. They continue to mine that group to generate as many sales as they can. The 2016 schedule, the actual dates will be announced in mid-April by the National Football League, and that's always an exciting day for us. We do know the opponents that will play this year. It'll be a good lineup in addition to our regular AFC South foes. We'll also face the Green Bay Packers, which is always an historic franchise you enjoy welcoming to your stadium, and the Super Bowl champion Denver Broncos will be here as well. So that's a quick run through of where we are right now on addressing our season tickets and ticket space, and we'd love to open it to any questions you might have. No one? Okay. Thank you very much.
Good morning, everyone. I want to say welcome to the new board members as well. We look forward to working with you over the coming few months and years, and so I'm glad to have you guys. They get to talk about all the exciting stuff, and I get stuck with the finances here. So maybe, let's see, it's not working. Not good. Derek, help me out. Stuart broke it, is what happened. Way to go, Stu. No. You want to just click for me about that? Okay, good. So we're going to start with the financial overview, the ticket user fee funds. Most of you guys are familiar with these funds, and there really has not been much change since we last met in February. Just as a reminder, there are two. There is one ticket tax, which is $3. Those are then divided into two different funds. One is the $2 fund, and the other is the dollar fund. The $2 fund has been pledged, and bonds were issued based off of the $2 ticket tax. And those monies went to build out a lot of the improvements with the boards, the elevators that were put in. The new distributed sound system was also installed as part of those bonds, the new control room. And so all of those bonds, the $2 ticket tax, supported those improvements. There is also, Derek, are you going to click for me? You got to stay up there, man. Okay, so as you can see, there you go. The $1 fund is divided into various funds, and the $1 fund was approved this past year, and it is going to the improvements for the expansion joint repair as well as the new seats that are here, and also some concrete repair work. The $1 fund, per the way the bonds were issued, the banks required those, that $1 fund, to be divided out into these various funds, which are the Stadium Revenue Fund, the Stadium Reserve Fund, and the Stadium Construction Fund. These funds, as a reminder, are kept by Metro, and Bob Lackey actually keeps track of all of those different funds and monitors these funds. So these numbers actually come from Bob Lackey at Metro. Okay? And can somebody click me through probably the next few? You can click through that. That's just a detail of the ins and outs of all of the various funds. And there again, there has been very, very little change in these funds since our last meeting. And if you can flip me, Ed, if you don't mind, thank you so much, to the ticket tax paid to date spreadsheet. And it looks like this. I'm so sorry. The total that has been paid in for all of the user fees since inception is $14.3 million to date. So that gives you an idea of the amount of money that has been put in. And then, like I said, the bonds were kind of issued for all those improvements. The next one is the user fee recap, and this is a report that we have given as a request from the board. This actually shows where we are. We paid out in full everything from the 2015 season for the Titans, and this shows what is being paid in for the 2016. So we do an estimate. That estimate is currently $1.6 million, and then that will be paid in 10 different installments. As games are played and our NFL box office statements are actually finalized after the game, then we do a true-up. If y'all, some of you guys can remember from last year, we'll do a true-up as that game is played and actually pay in any difference. Okay, and the next one is the capital fund summary. Again, this is a fund that is kept by Bob Lackey at Metro, and this currently has a balance of $157,000. We did receive our reimbursement this past month for the $1,055,000 that you'll see there as the capital fund expense. So that money was based off of the reimbursement that was approved by this board, and then that payment came to us just this past month. And the next slide is the capital fund summary. This again shows all of the activity in this fund since inception of the fund. Okay, thank you so much. The next piece, this shows our current unfiled reimbursement receivable, which Ralph did a great job of explaining that. It's currently at $3.3 million, and then there's a casualty receivable of about $23,000, and Walter also just informed me that we just got a check from Metro to pay off some of that casualty receivable as well. And then the last thing is the Nissan Stadium CapEx communication tool. This was a tool that was really developed as a result of a meeting with Metro and Monica, where we wanted to really enhance the communication that was provided to the board in regards to all of the CapEx projects that are going on. They have been divided into three categories. One is completed projects, so that's projects that are fully complete and no more expense will be incurred to date. The second is current ongoing projects, and on that tab you'll be able to see what we have incurred to date and also an estimate of what we think that total project will cost. And then the third tab is the anticipated projects. And so these are projects that we know are coming down the pike. Some of them we actually have real proposals on and we've gotten information. Some are TBD, which means we haven't gone out and gotten a firm proposal yet, but we are working towards that process. I've also taken the liberty at the request of Metro. One of the things that was asked for is, can we go ahead and get copies of all the invoices, proposals, contracts, etc. And so I'm planning to present this awesome binder to Monica today. It is divided out in those three categories, and then it's tabbed by project that's listed on the communication tool with copies of all the invoices, proposals, contracts that have been executed, etc. It's a lot. We have also, Steve has done a letter that has gone back to Margaret Darby with, she had requested this information, and so Steve has also prepared a letter that we've just given to them today that kind of talks about this document and all of that kind of going back. So anyway, do I have any questions on any of the financial information?
Questions for Janine?
Yeah, I have a couple. I just want to go back over and make sure I understand the where we are, what we have in the capital fund, what the obligations are?
Sure.
Because I understand you've got $157,000 in the fund right now.
That's correct.
And that's funded by the ticket tax?
That actually is not. That is funded by the $1 million contribution that Metro makes out of the capital fund.
Okay. Metro contributes $1 million a year to the capital fund?
Correct.
And right now, you've got unfiled capital reimbursement of totaling 3.3?
We totaled 3.3. There is also a Wi-Fi receivable that's out there of about 2.5, which Ralph alluded to, the total receivable of around $5 million.
Okay, and you also have anticipated the according to the handout, you've got there was a $5,125,318 anticipated capital expenditures coming forward. Is that
That's
right?
That's correct, and those will be incurred over the next several years.
What is the total of the unreimbursed, the current project, and the anticipated projects?
So the current receivable we have is a 3.3 plus the 2.5, and then if you add the total there of the anticipated projects, that gives you the total of what the receivable will be once all those projects are completed. Again, steadily, those anticipated projects will be done and implemented kind of over time, so it's kind of a little bit of a moving target. Also, this coming in the new budget cycle, Metro will put in another $1 million into the CapEx fund.
No, I understand. What I'm trying to get at is, I mean, it looks like, based on the numbers in the Finance Committee and we discussed today, we've got about $8 million in capital expenditures.
Yes.
And Metro is contributing $1 million a year. And the point I want to make is just I think that it would be prudent to ask Metro Finance to come up with a recommendation as to how they recommend that this be paid off over time.
Yes, I agree. I think that's part of really, well, two separate things. I think with the Finance Committee making the request on improving the planning for capital projects and the new communication tool, I think that's part of it. But yes, I mean, certainly we need to make sure that this is on everyone's radar, which I know Bob Lackey was part of the discussion. No, he's not here today.
He's not.
Yeah. But, and I want to emphasize, you know, you have done a really nice job of giving us the information. And you laid it out at the last Finance Committee meeting. We really appreciate it. Steve was there to answer all our questions. And now we see what the potential issue is. And now that you've laid it out, I think we ought to just evaluate what our obligations are and, you know, what's owed and how we're going to pay for it. And so I think that we just need to, a big part of that is Mr. Lackey and Mr. Riebling. Coming up because they're the ones who are in charge of the finances.
Sure, and I think it's a great opportunity for us all to sit down, continuing that communication.
Absolutely.
To talk about ways. You know, we've always feel like we've been great partners with Metro and with the Sports Authority, and, you know, I think Ralph alluded to that, and I think that's something that we certainly will continue to do, and something that Steve alluded to as well.
Right.
It's certainly not a pressing receivable, but, you know, the stadium is, you know, getting older. And a lot of these things that are on the list have reached their useful life, or frankly, they're no longer supported. You know, we have an analog security system. Well, I mean, do I need to say anything else about that, right? Some of the freight elevators, the controllers, are just, they don't work anymore. Well, if a freight elevator goes down in the middle of an event, that, you know, that could have some serious ramifications. So I think continuing that partnership, continuing that dialogue, having us all sit around the table to talk about it, I think is a great step. And I think the communication tool, and I really appreciate, you know, the Sports Authority coming back and saying, hey, can we get all this information? Because we want to be proactive, and I think that's great. So I think we really appreciate it too.
Monica, will you take the lead on coordinating a follow-up meeting with Metro Legal, Metro Finance, a representative from the board?
Yeah, we can definitely do that, and I know the Finance Committee will continue to meet. And at the last Finance Committee meeting, then Steve Underwood also suggested that we sit down together. So I think that we can start with Metro and begin to look at the plan.
Right, and just come up with a recommendation. Come up with a tangible, I mean, a firm recommendation about how to handle that issue, because basically Metro is expending $1 million a year, and there's now $5 million that's already booked and another, some additional funds that are already anticipated will never catch up unless we address the problem.
Thank you. Thank you, Janine.
Thank you all so much.
Yes, ma'am. Just to show my lack of history, I'm on your ticket tax page, and your revenue has gone up from 2010. Is that selling more tickets, or the ticket tax went up?
So the ticket tax originally was $2, and then it went up to $3. But in addition to that, we have really tried to do a great job of pulling in additional events into Nissan Stadium, as you know, you saw Walter talk about with the soccer, Beyonce, Monster Jam. We hope to have another announcement soon of another event coming. And so we have really made a concerted effort to really utilize Nissan Stadium and get more people here. And you know, Nashville is a great destination. I mean, it's amazing how many people want to come here, as evidenced not only by our success, by Bridgestone's success as well with pulling events. And so it's twofold. It's both. But excellent question.
Emma?
Well, your question was in line with what I was going to mention. I had a chance to attend the last finance committee meeting, and it was like lights were being turned on for me too, things that I didn't know. And that would be a good idea for the new members, if you have a chance to come to the next committee meeting and understand a little bit deeper as to what the problems are. Might not be the good word, but the issues that we need to bring up, like Dudley was mentioning there. And we got to make sure that we protect Bob, because he has so much information in his head that we need to get out.
Yeah. And again, I want to just say again, Titans have been really good at communicating. We really appreciate the information. And now that you put the information in front of us, it's our responsibility to figure out how to address the issues. So, and I think that that's why. I just like to ask that there be. I'll put it in form of a motion. I move that we request from Metro Finance a recommendation on how Metro's capital obligations under the lease to the Titans are going to be met going forward. How they're going to be funded.
Second.
Do we need that in a motion? Jason, or
just that was a motion.
But to be able to, is that does the body need to act in the form of a motion?
I think before any action is taken on the recommendation, I don't know if it's necessary in order to get a recommendation, certainly to take any action on the recommendation subsequent, but I don't think it's inappropriate.
Okay. Great. The will of the body is a motion for. Per Dudley's request, and I think we have a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you all so much. Appreciate it.
Happy St. Patty's.
Now we will hear more about Titan Stadium from our owner's rep and Commonwealth of Illinois.
Well, thank you. I will be brief. My goal is to beat Sean's timing, so I'll see what I can do. So I thought I'd touch on five areas real quick this morning. Seat replacement, repairs, a little insight into our quality control and assurance methods that we're doing, schedule and budget. So as you are familiar, we have taken off all of the seats on the upper west deck, which is the photograph, and have started to reinstall them. As of this morning, we have 4,000 seats that are completely reinstalled, 8,000 seats which are ready for the bottoms to be put in, so the backs and the brackets are already in. And we're going to try to move at a pace of about 2,000 a day, putting bottoms in. So our goal is to finish as quick as we can the upper west deck. Now what we've learned as we've gone through this is a number of things. I'm going to touch on that in just a minute on repairs. But when we go up there later, if you'd like to go, you'll see that we have torn out a lot. The restrooms have all been stripped out. The concession stands are all stripped out. And that's largely due to the waterproofing objective that we have to try to get this building sealed back up. So it's not only expansion joints, but we're replacing a lot of flooring and then damaged concrete. So as it relates to repairs for damages or other repairs, we have a team, as we are pulling out the seats, we go through and we try to figure out what needs to be repaired. We've got a group of engineers that are doing that. Part of that is scientific, and part of it is just going through with a series of hammers and figuring out what concrete is bad, what steps need to be repaired, what bolt joints need to be repaired. And back up one to the pressure washing ad, if you would, please. And as Walter alluded to, when we started to pull out the seats, we noticed the pic photo on the left that looked pretty ugly. So we started, in conjunction with the Titans, pressure washing everything as we pull out the seats, which just cleans it up a whole bunch. And then moving to the expansion joints, we have torn out a whole host of them. Now, for those of you, if I use construction lingo, just stop me. But an expansion joint allows the building to stretch and flex with the heat. And that was the source of a majority of the leaks. So they were just old and worn out. So you physically go in and you cut them out. There's 2 miles of them in this building, at roughly the 30-yard line and the 70-yard line. Goes right through every aspect of the building. So we're taking those out as we go. Now, to put them back, we have to go and measure them. The engineer's got to figure out exactly the thing. It's called a shop drawing. It comes back, we check it, and then we send it back for manufacturing, and in 2 or 3 to 4 weeks, we get it back. So we've got a lot pulled out. When you go up there, you'll see. Big ones are the photo on the left. Small ones are the photo on the right. So they're pulled out, they're ready to go back in, and then we'll patch the concrete around them. Moving on, Ed. And in addition, we're sealing all the cracks we can find with various epoxies and things to try to seal this building up as best we know how. In addition to that, there's concrete repairs where concrete is just cracked on the concourses, or for some reason it has failed. We're chipping that out, we're cutting it out, and we're coming up with fixes for it. Part of that entails coming up with the right design for that. So we're keeping a group of engineers that are specialists in expansion joints and concrete repairs here pretty much all the time, working with our contractors and subcontractors. Let me touch a little bit on quality control, which we rarely talk about, but I want you to know that this is going on in the background. So when all the new bolts we're putting in for the seats, we randomly test the strength of those bolts, so that how much will they fail when you pull them out. And we have a test for that, and we're documenting all that. I'm sure my lawyer friends in the room will do. So we will create this pretty extensive project history and all these documents. We're looking at, as in this photograph, various samples for floor finishes in the bathrooms. We've now picked about 75% of all the things we have to pick, along with the engineer. This is the new bathroom floor finishes, and the key here is getting a product that will seal real well, that won't slip too much, but will still can be cleaned. So we've done that now. The device in the right photo is a device that when we put the floor down, we test its ability to adhere to the concrete. So we want that to be as good as we know how to make it. The other things we're testing as part of quality control is concrete design. We've got a concrete testing firm that will be here, and that's probably more information than you know. And when I explained this to Monica the other day, she looked at me kind of funny and thought all concrete was the same. It's not. We're making a specific kind of concrete up on the decks, so it's close to where we apply it, but the mix and the temperature and all those things that are important to us construction junkies happen. In addition, we're testing anchors for seats. We're also testing handrails. And as we repair them, we're checking them, because there's a little variation in the way the codes are written today versus when the stadium was built. All that being said, that's what project managers do. We try to keep track of all this stuff and make it happen and still meet our time and money obligations. As it relates to the schedule, kind of had our first test with the soccer match. Could we get out of the way so they could do an event? That was kind of easy because they were using the lower part of the stadium, though we did have a backup area if they had to go up on the upper east deck. The big one for us will be Beyonce, because we got to kind of get done, sort of put it all back together, back out, have the concert, and then we'll go back to work. So we're constantly moving and adjusting schedules. Part of that is what we find. We have to go back and repair. then we adjust schedule. So the logistics game of this is pretty intense. It's not fun. It's not glamorous. We just do it. If you walk, when you walk through the building onto the truck dock, you'll see chairs stacked everywhere. And the supply of chairs coming in is moving pretty regularly. Also, the supply going out to the recyclers and that sort of thing is ongoing. So our big goal is still to try to have all this done by the start of the football season. If for some reason we can't, in the schedule that we have a B plan that takes it beyond the football season. Budget-wise, we've only spent actually dollars out the door, just under $500,000 so far. That's starting to ramp up as we're starting to get more invoices in right now. Our biggest challenge is looking at what has to be repaired, because some of that you just can't figure out till you look at it and match that up with the budget. The guys have been doing a lot of that lately. We think we're fine because we put a lot of contingencies and a lot of allowances in the early budget. And as my commitment to the people that we represent is, we will tell you about the good, the bad, and the ugly of construction. So that is our report. I'm happy to answer any questions.
So do you think we're relatively on schedule?
We are relatively on schedule for what we know today.
Okay.
And normally I'm much more definitive than that when I talk about schedule, but because we're dealing with an unknown here, so when we take something out, we find something wrong, we come up with a fix.
Okay.
And that's constantly adjusting on the schedule. Same on the budget.
Right.
Other questions?
Larry Adama of Commonwealth Development. I don't think you introduced yourself.
Senior Project and Development Manager.
So the bathrooms, that was a surprise. Was that part of,
yes.
I don't remember that. Because we always talk about seats and expansion joint.
It's kind of one of the little behind the details. Some of the expansion joints go through bathrooms and concessions areas. Some of them have cracks. That's all part of trying to seal up that upper deck so the water doesn't move down through. So we'll start here shortly to put some of those back. Some of the new flooring is down, and then part of that is they're cleaning right behind us. So it'll be a pretty much improved bathroom and concession areas as we go back through. Anything else? If you want to go upstairs later on and see our world, please join us.
Thank you.
Excellent.
I think we do. Okay. At this time, we have our update from Monica on where we are with the Nissan Stadium electric vehicle chargers proposal. We heard part of that last month, but deferred action until today's meeting. So.
Right. So. As a reminder, and especially for our new members and for those of you who were not here last month, Nissan North America is requesting 6 parking spaces in the north side of Lot R for the installation of 3 electric vehicle charging stations. And this will be done at no cost to the Sports Authority. NRG, EVgo is the company that's working with Nissan. And so they will install the chargers at their sole cost and expense. And they'll be responsible for all maintenance and operation for electricity. And so it's not going to cost us anything. This is a 10-year agreement that we're looking at with automatic month-to-month renewals. And like our chair said last month, we recommended that the board defer approval because there were still some questions that we had with regards to the license agreement, the terms and conditions, specifically around termination. And so over the last month, Margaret Darby and I have had multiple conversations with Nissan and NRG. I've been out to the lot, we've walked the site, we've looked at installation, and really have kind of come to an agreement and feel very comfortable. What we've, if you look at the terms and conditions, in regards to termination, because we wanted to make sure that we could terminate without liability. And so what we have agreed upon is that the Sports Authority would have the right to terminate the agreement without liability with 90 days prior written notice of termination to EVgo, following a finding by formal action, either by us or by the Metro Council, that termination is required to provide for the public health and safety. And
well-being. So that's the process. We just wanted to make sure that we are protected. You know, you just don't know what you don't know, and we were not comfortable entering into an agreement where now, if for some reason, some unforeseen reason, we need to terminate the agreement, and there's some liability. So we have come to agreement. I think everybody feels good about it. We also have said that we will make sure that NRG and Nissan have access to our shared calendar. They're aware that there may be some days where they just can't. They won't have access to the lots because of other, you know, contractual things. So they're comfortable with that. Margaret is sick today. Jason is here. I'm not sure if you want to add anything.
Nothing past that. I spoke with Margaret about this. She didn't raise any issues and said everything was satisfactory.
So we are comfortable, and we recommend approval.
Does Metro derive any income from this?
We do not. No, there's
Does Nissan,
no income, no expense.
Does Nissan?
Nissan will, if you, where's
We have
Anthony?
Representatives from Nissan.
Yes, Anthony.
Well, like I said, no, we're not deriving any income, because in fact, it's a major investment. So with the challenge of the installation, we're looking at around $100,000 for expense. So the money that's deriving from the charge will go on operating and also into ongoing maintenance.
And did I understand it was three
chargers.
Chargers, but it's going to take up six.
Anthony, why don't you join us?
And my name is Anthony Lampkin from Nissan North America. I'm on the EV infrastructure team. So there are three chargers. Two will be DC fast chargers, able to charge an electric vehicle in under 30 minutes. And one will be a level two with two ports that will be able to charge a vehicle in 4 to 8 hours. So that would be more use for the games and people that want to spend a little bit more time.
And the way that the customer uses it would be with the credit card?
That is correct, yes. Okay. They have a credit card, and they also have RFID card access as well. So in every one of our cars, there is a RFID card that comes in the glove box, and they'll be able to use that. But any other automotive manufacturer would be able to use the charging stations with a credit card. That's correct.
Okay.
Thanks, Anthony.
Thank you.
So, Monica, today, or I guess Jason, there's a resolution. Was there something that came in late today? Did you bring a resolution for this?
That's for a separate.
Oh, okay.
We have
All
a resolution.
Right. So then we need a motion to approve.
Yes.
The resolution that's included in the packet, which would authorize the Sports Authority to contract with NRG EV Services for the installation, maintenance, and provision of electric charging stations in Lot R.
Right, and they're estimating that installation would take maybe 6 weeks, and they'll fence off those particular spaces just for public safety.
Okay. So we need a motion to that effect. Would the authority for the chair to authorize, is that correct?
Yes.
Okay.
So moved. Second.
Motion is second. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Thank you. Motion carries. And now, Monica, give us an update on what's going on with the competitor group license agreement.
Well, I think most of you know that the Country Music Marathon, now the Rock and Roll Marathon, uses Nissan Stadium for parking. The marathon is on April 30th this year. They also will use some of the lots, Sports Authority lots, on the days leading up to the race for a water station set up and for volunteer parking for the Health and Fitness Expo that takes place leading up to the race day. And so Competitor Group, Inc. is the company. They will pay the Sports Authority $10,000 for the use of the fee. That's the rental fee, and it's been the same since I've been here. In the past, they have submitted a civic event application, and we kind of went through the process because the marathon is considered a civic event. But we just feel that a more formal agreement is appropriate, just given the nature of the event, the scale, it's just one of the city's premier events. I've met with the marathon people as part of the mayor's special events team, and they are comfortable and good with moving to the license agreement. We have a resolution that we received this morning, and so we would ask approval of that as well. If there
but I'm happy to take any questions.
I'll move adoption.
Second.
Okay, good. So adoption and a second for approval of the agreement?
Yeah. Resolution.
Or both. Do we need two separate motions?
The resolution is similar to the charging station. The resolution authorizes Sports Authority to execute the license agreement.
All right. Thank you. So we have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries. Thank you for that update, Monica. Now we have the Bridgestone Arena Ford Ice Center report by representatives of the Nashville Predators. They're still awake back there. Thanks, guys.
Good morning. I'm Kyle Clayton with the Bridgestone Arena, Nashville Predators, and Ford Ice Center. Here in a few minutes, I'll bring up my good buddy, Mr. David Kells. We'll do a bit of a tag team presentation today. I look forward to the jokes of the two-for-one special since Sean Henry can't present today, but I'm sure he's already tweeted out a few things about, you know, pictures of me or whatever standing up here. So, see, I knew it. But I do promise you one thing. We'll give you just as much information as Sean gives you, but in about half the time. So we'll keep this moving. You're all welcome for that. So I'm going to kind of recap January, things that happened in the past. The presentation you have in front of you should be for the month of January. And it was a huge month for us in all fashion. Obviously, we had the All-Star game. We've talked about it multiple times. We talked about it ramping up to it. This may be the last time, probably not, but we'll keep talking about it. It was just a great overall event for our city between the outdoor concert series, the ice rink outside, everything that came together for that one event, just everybody in Nashville pulling together. It was extremely special. And along with that, it ties into everything else we're doing. It helps generate more events, more revenues for us, and obviously for the city, but especially for Bridgestone Arena. Through the end of January, we were sitting at about $7.3 million in revenue, which is the earliest operating month we've ever hit that number in our history. So it's just fantastic that we're trending that way. We're 23% ahead of last year where we were, and 8% ahead of our pretty aggressive budget this year. When we set this budget last year, we were pretty aggressive. We thought this might be kind of a down year because you never know how those event schedules are going to turn, and really it's just been a fantastic year. And we're really excited about next year, but focusing on this year is just a great place to be. Our expenses obviously are tracking up too. As you have more events, you have more expenses, but still they're only about 14% ahead of last year. So again, we're just having a great overall year, especially on the financial side, and that's with doing some renovation projects of our own, but capturing those within our operating expenses, because we're extending our capital improvements fund projects to the seating renovations, which are currently going on. So that fund is kind of capped out at the moment until we have some more availability to fund some of those projects. So we're doing some restroom renovations of our own, some painting projects. We upgraded our lighting system, and all that was done within our operating expenses, which are still tracking well to previous years. In January, we had the Harlem Globetrotters came back from a few-year break where they were at a municipal auditorium. At 10,000 people in the building that night. Madonna made her first ever trip to Bridgestone Arena, which was a great night. Tool fans, you may remember, it snowed the night before, and everybody was worried we were going to have to cancel the show or postpone it or whatever. Those fans braved the weather. They were there. There was over 15,000 people in the building that night. It was huge. Great event. And one that we're really excited about is Monster Jam. It's an annual event for us. We had 30,000 people in the building over the course of 2 days. We're very excited to see how that event has grown. Now it's going to come over to Nissan Stadium. Glad that we're able to help that situation and bring it over here. It's just a great way of all of us combining together to do something great for Nashville. On the hockey side of things, other than the All-Star game, I think we only had 3 home games, but one of the biggest deals that we made was we acquired Ryan Johansson from Columbus Blue Jackets, and that deal just keeps paying dividends. I heard talk on the radio this morning about how just that one move has shifted our center position to, you're dropping Mike Ribeiro to the second line, Mike Fisher to the third line. It just helps develop the whole line and all of our lineup, and it's allowing Philip Forsberg to not have as much attention on him. James Neal's capitalizing on it. It's a great time for us as we're ramping up for the playoffs. We're sitting in a very, very excited position. Touching back on the All-Star game real quick, one thing that we had was the All-Star Legacy Project, which helps fund a project of the Nashville Inner City Ministry. It was a huge project between the Predators, the NHL, and their partner McDonald's. They came in, and we transformed a 90,000 square foot facility for the Nashville Center Inner City Ministry. They have a pantry with Second Harvest Food Bank there, a lot of after-school programs. It's just a great overall project. We were very excited we were able to be a part of that. And then Ford Ice Center. As part of the All-Star festivities, they hosted a huge junior All-Star tournament with teams from just about every NHL market that were here. We also, on top of that, had 2 more tournaments. Between all 3 tournaments, we had 120 teams visit Southeast Davidson County, which is just fantastic. We are gearing up for our next round of leagues. We have over 550 adult skaters in our adult league program right now. I think we have over 300 kids in our termite and mite in our youth league programs. It's just fantastic. Our learn to skate programs are going through the roof. Danny Butler in the back right here, he's done an outstanding job of growing those programs through initiatives that we've built along with cooperation from the NHL. We're just so excited of what that building is becoming, what it's still becoming. We're, you know, through the moon. I don't think anybody really knew what that building was going to be when we said what we hoped it would be, but it has just grown by leaps and bounds. If anybody has any questions on the financials or recap of the past before I bring David Kells up, I'd be happy to answer them.
Any questions?
All right, Mr. Kells.
Presentation.
Hi there, I am David Kells. I'm Senior Vice President of Booking for Bridgestone Arena and the Nashville Predators. Thank you all for having us today. As Kyle hit on our financials from January, I'm going to look at kind of where we were last week and going forward. As Monica mentioned, we just wrapped up the SEC basketball tournament, the men's tournament this year. Always a great way to showcase downtown Nashville, Bridgestone Arena, and show that we really are a great event city for the participants and tourists coming to town and the folks who produce large, you know, national events. The SEC, always, we have a recap meeting every day. Jeremy Merriweather in the back was our events lead and kind of ran point with us on those. One of the things that maybe caught the SEC off guard, they thought they saw an issue. When we have a quick turnaround between events, one tournament ends, we have to get, you know, 17,000 people out of the arena, clean the arena, open the doors in like an hour. We view that as an all hands on deck situation. Everybody from the offices, operations, cleaning staff all work together. It's called a brush back. We knock out, going through, picking up the popcorn, picking up the soda cans, picking up the nachos, and it's everybody. It's people in the suits who were making phone calls 30 minutes ago to the folks who are regularly in operations and our event staff. And one of the SEC guys asked us, were you guys short staff? What happened with that? We go, no, this is what we do. We, for our large events and any event that we have, it's all hands on deck. It's everybody jumping in and pitching in to help so we can make these things as successful as possible and bring them back. And in an odd way, it is fun for everybody. You know, everybody puts on the rubber gloves, grabs a mop, fills up their bags with trash, and high fives at the end at how fast we could clean their area, and then you're shouting at the folks in the next area that need to step up their game and get their area cleaned as well. The SEC was just one of the big events that we have kind of bookend, or in the middle of a bookend of a busy start time. From February 29th to this Friday, we will have hosted 15 ticketed events in 19 days, bringing approximately 300,000 people through the doors. It started with WWE, a couple of Predators games, two sold-out Blake Shelton shows, SEC basketball in the middle. Last night, we had the Kris Kristofferson tribute show. Tonight's a hockey game again, and then on Friday with Rihanna. On the attendance side for the team, the team has sold out 28 of 33 home games so far this season, putting us on pace to tops last season's record of 30 sellouts. So we expect to beat that one. Kyle also touched on some of our community involvement through the All-Star game. Going forward, this 31st of March, we'll have the Nashville Predators wine tasting. The Predators will also be awarding over $450,000 worth of grants to the community in the next coming weeks. Something else unique that we're doing three broadcast takeovers. Three of our upcoming away games, we're going to take over the broadcast from the shoulder programming and focus on community initiatives that we have. One game will focus on the Fordyce Center and growing amateur hockey in the area. The second game will focus on the Predators 365 Fund. And the final game will focus on the Nashville Predators' support of the men program. Out at Fordyce Center, we recently hosted the Nashville Predators High School Predators Cup, which is the championship for the state. It culminated with something that shows how hockey is growing in the area. Dan Kesmer, a former Nashville Predator, is now the coach at Ravenwood High School, and his team won the championship. So it shows that over the decades, people are making roots in the area, and hockey is becoming more and more part of our whole overall community. Also on this Sunday, March 20th, the Predators will practice out at Fordyce Center. That is open to the community, open to all of y'all to stop in and see. This is just another way of us driving our fans and more traffic to the Fordyce Center and the whole Antioch area. On the ice, Thursday begins a stretch that we'll play eight of our final 12 games at home, which is great to be at home towards the end of the season. Guys aren't traveling as much. You get that fan home energy behind you, driving things towards the playoffs as we're making that way. We recently capped off a franchise record 14-point game streak and 13-game point streak on the road. Those are both franchise records. Never happened before with us. Philip Forsberg is one of the hottest players in the NHL during the month of November, becoming the first player to reach the first player in 30 years to notch two natural hat tricks in the span of 5 days. So a natural hat trick is three games in a row in succession. So it's not like he scored two, somebody else scored one, he scored the third, three goals in a row in within a five-game period. We're also going to celebrate a couple of veterans this month. We just celebrated Mike Ribeiro's 1,000th game, and on Monday's game, we'll celebrate Mike Fisher's 1,000th NHL game. Looking to the future, the Hockey World Cup will happen this September in Toronto. We're lucky to have four players named to those teams. Roman Josi will be part of Team Europe, Philip Forsberg, Team Sweden, Pekka Rinne, Team Finland, Shea Weber was part of Team Canada. So that's exciting stuff coming for September. And like I mentioned, we're in the thick of the playoff race right now. 2 weeks ago, we thought we had locked down the first wild card spot. We were already making trips planned on who we were going to play opponent-wise. We were making budgets based on that. It's amazing what has changed in the last 2 weeks. Things above us have shuffled. We've shuffled up a little bit. So we don't know where we're going to be playing. We know we are going to be playing. It could be a central opponent. It could be a Pacific opponent. But as of today, we're sitting 8 points behind a first place in the central with a game in hand on the Dallas Stars. So that's an awesome place to be right this time of year. And building on that excitement of the playoffs, we are also in the middle of our renewal season for season ticket holders for the 16-17 year. And we're pacing towards a 95% renewal for next season. That's what I've got. Anything else? Any questions on events coming up? Recap from the SEC?
Any questions for David?
Did you guys do a rush back between the afternoon session and the evening session?
Correct. That's when we do those. And so those happened on the Thursday and Friday events. We also do them for things like Disney on Ice and the circus and those kind of events.
Because there were a lot of Kentucky fans out there before they started. And I had a cousin who came down from Lexington. I was out there with him, and he was
Do you see that big sea of blue outside?
There was
for sure.
A big sea of blue, yeah.
All right.
Thank you, David.
Thank you all very much.
Thanks, David.
Impressive, fast-speaking presentation. thank you, Kyle. First Tennessee Park. It's almost baseball time. We are fired up.
3 weeks. I'm Doug Scopel, Vice President of Operations for the Nashville Sounds. And good morning, everyone. 3 weeks from tonight is our season opener for the Sounds. So we got a lot of activity going on at the ballpark, as I've alluded to in previous meetings. Get ready to go. Since our last meeting here, our individual tickets have gone on sale. We've released our promotional schedule, which I believe was sent out to you guys. You can see all the fun activities we've got planned from throughout our years with our 72 home dates. It's been a good start to us with ticket sales. We are different. Last year at this time, we're all looking at cranes and construction crews and everybody working their butts off to get the ballpark open. This year, we've got a full season behind us, so we can sell that experience, bring people out, show them a ballpark. So from that perspective, we're pacing ahead of last year in all our sales areas just because of having that and having just the word of mouth and the success of our first season. This past week, we hosted events for our suite holders and our season ticket members out at the ballpark, which was our chance to give out tickets, welcome them, food, drink, just to welcome some familiar faces back and ready for baseball season. Mother Nature has been on our side. We've had beautiful weather this week. That helps get people thinking about baseball as well. Work at the ballpark, phase two, I've mentioned a few times. That's the part that's beyond the outfield that connects down to the new state garage. That work is underway. Should be done by the end of next week. And this meeting is at our ballpark next month, so we'll hopefully be able to show you guys all that and see all that plus all the other changes that have happened for that. Sort of tied into phase two, but separate, is something that Monica's been working on and we've talked about before, is the Ed Temple statue that is out on the Fifth Avenue Entry Plaza is going to move slightly into a grass area to be part of that new expanded area. They poured the footing yesterday, and that statue is planned to move next week, I believe. I don't know if you have anything else on
Wednesday.
That. Yeah, Wednesday. So we'll be able to, Ed will still be a part of our experience, just in a slightly different location. I have met with Metro Police, Public Works about our traffic parking plan. If you guys remember, about a year ago, a bunch of us sat at a table and we're trying to figure out, we've never done this before, how's everything going to flow? Last year was a really smooth operation. This year we have the addition of the state garage, so just kind of tweaking traffic flow. We felt like everything was good there. We're going to add we were really surprised by how many Uber, cab, pedestrian bikes came to the ballpark, which is great. So we're adding a specific lane for that the police and Public Works will set up that'll help make traffic even a little more smooth on the Fifth Avenue side of the ballpark this year. So that's something we're going to have addition there. Starting to get out in the community a little bit. Our mascot's been out with our tickets going on sale, with Little League starting up. We get out and try to get involved in the youth programs. And with our season starting up, we'll have a lot more activity out in the community, which I'll share with you in the future. From a baseball perspective, the first minor league spring training games happened yesterday. So the Sounds, when they get here in 3 weeks, we don't know who's going to be on the team, but they're starting to play down in Arizona. So that's all going well. And one other event we have coming up that I've mentioned is on the 29th of March, which is a week and a half now, we have the Vanderbilt-Belmont game, which is an additional thing we're going to do. Ticket sales for that are going much better than we expected. We honestly thought a Tuesday night college game that we'd never done before would be more of a walk-up game. We've already sold over 2,000, approaching 2,500 tickets for that one. And a lot of interest from both the student bodies from the schools, which is great to see they're interested in. And if we have great weather that week, I think that'll help that out. Just one more event that we can do at our ballpark. That concludes my report, unless you guys have any questions. Like I said, our meeting is next month at the ballpark, and we'll be able to share a lot more and hopefully walk you around and show you some of these things.
Thank you, Doug.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. We have a lot going on in our facilities, obviously. It's an exciting time to be part of the Sports Authority. One thing Monica and I discussed a little bit is maybe having a facility liaison for the different venues that we oversee. And so I know we've put together the Finance Committee, which is really helping hopefully streamline our work and make sure we're crunching into the numbers. And then on this facility liaison piece, I think it would be helpful if any board members have an interest in serving in that capacity. Just ask if you think about your time commitment and ability, and if you have an interest, to please reach out to Monica. That might be something that we would try and appoint a few different members to participate in. So please consider that. We really appreciate everyone presenting today. If you want to stick around and come check out the activity here at Nissan Stadium and see the improvements, well, we encourage you to do so. And finally, Coach Temple is continuing to recover from his recent procedures, I guess. He hopes to be at our next meeting. I know Monica has talked to his daughter. And if there's no other business, and since Coach can't be here to make the motion to adjourn, someone make a motion to adjourn and we'll get out of here.
Motion to adjourn.
Thank you.